All right, folks, we're going to go ahead and get started. Thanks everybody for tuning in. This is our first go around with one of these. My name is Pat Kane. I'm the Public Programs and Visitor Services Coordinator at the Museum of the Grand Prairie. And thanks for tuning in to this first ever Facebook Live virtual tour of the Grand Prairie Story, one of our main exhibit spaces at the museum. As you can see, I'm not at the museum right now. I'm broadcasting live from my home. If you're interested and you are open to sharing that information, let us know where you're watching from. Are you watching from right here in Champaign County too, someplace else in Illinois, someplace across the United States, someplace across the world? Leave a comment in the comments and let us know where you're watching from tonight. Before we get started, I did want to go over a few things. First thing, if you have any questions or any comments, or if something is wrong with the stream, please leave a comment in the comments right next to the video, under the video, however you're watching. Another thing, I'd like to let you know about a few other things that we're doing at the museum, how we are currently coping with the whole COVID-19 crisis, this global pandemic. How is it affecting us at the Museum of the Grand Prairie? So we are closed to the public up until at least April 12th. Our museum's closed, but we're still doing some stuff behind the scenes and ramping up a whole bunch of content on our social media pages, on our Facebook page, which you're watching from right now. Also on our Twitter page, you can find us at you can find us at MUS Grand Prairie. You can find us on Instagram. We are at Museum of the Grand Prairie there. And this week, we just started two new social media accounts for the museum. We're now on YouTube. We have a YouTube channel. We also have Goodreads, where museum staff are going to share some awesome books that we have read and we want to share with our museum followers as well. So follow us on social media during this COVID-19 crisis for a whole bunch of awesome content that we are going to try and push out, even though the museum is closed. Some other things, a colleague of mine, Katie Snyder, I think she's watching. She's been doing an awesome job collaborating with some local community organizations and doing some awesome stuff, working with Shambana Moms, Kakoop Adventure Play in the Urbana Arts and Culture Program for some awesome projects, some of which have already happened and are ongoing. Was today, another round of Chalk Your Walk, which is a pretty awesome thing where we're encouraging the public to use sidewalk chalk to write on their sidewalks as they're out walking about, getting that essential exercise and activity in. Another activity has been an awesome bear hunt where people across the county, I've even seen it in different parts of the country too, are putting teddy bears in the windows of their homes and encouraging people to find those as they walk around for a little teddy bear hunt. Another upcoming program happening on Monday is a program called Hearts for Healthcare, where Katie, on behalf of the Museum of the Grand Prairie, has collaborated with, again, Coop Adventure Play, ShambanaMoms.com, and the Urbana Arts and Culture Program for Hearts for Healthcare. Monday, March 30th is National Doctor Day, and we are encouraging folks to, work together with their families, you know, even some kids out there, decorate a heart, put it in your window to help advocate for those healthcare professionals on National Doctor Day, some pretty important people at this point in time. Do that as well. Lastly, I did want to let you know the Museum of the Grand Prairie, we're part of the Champaign County Forest Preserve District. And even though public facilities in the Forest Preserve District are currently closed, such as the museum, the forest preserves themselves, the outdoor areas are open for you to explore at Lake of the Woods Forest Preserve in Mahomet, Sangamon River Forest Preserve, close to Fisher, River Bend Forest Preserve, which is also in Mahomet, Homer Lake Forest Preserve, near St. Joseph and Homer. Middle Fork River Forest Preserve, our largest forest preserve closer to Penfield on the far northeastern part of the county, and the Kickapoo Rail Trail. You can explore all of those. And a cool thing that's going on right now that we've been doing for the past couple of years around the Forest Preserve District is our Easter egg hunt. There's these massive 50 to 60 pound concrete eggs that our garden and operations staff have decorated wonderfully and placed throughout forest preserves, and encouraging people to go around and find those, or do your best to find those Easter eggs. So those are already placed. There's 30 of them at all, 30 of them scattered throughout the county forest preserve. So go and check those out, take pictures of those. Be sure to tag the Forest Preserve District in any of those pictures that you post on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Okay, one other thing I did want to let you know, there is a roughly 10 to 15 second delay between when I talk and when it's actually broadcast on Facebook Live. So if you ask a question and I don't answer it immediately, it's, you know, partly because of that delay. I may also be trying to think of an answer. I may not have seen your question just yet. So hang tight. I'll do my best to answer any and all those questions. But if you have any questions or comments over the course of this stream, again, please feel free to leave them in the comments. And I'm seeing some good postings from people. We see people watching in Rantoul, in Champaign and Urbana, and even Cynthia in Boynton Beach, Florida, lived in Mahomet for 27 years and she loved the museum. So thanks to everybody for watching. So let's go ahead and instead of me talking, let's go ahead and start this virtual exhibit tour. All right, so I'm gonna share my computer screen. We're gonna play some in-depth exhibit video that was previously shot at the museum. And I'm gonna talk you through what we see going on in that video. Okay, so we're starting first, walking into the Museum of the Grand Prairie. So if you've never been to the Museum of the Grand Prairie, we're a cultural and natural history museum. And our mission is to collect, preserve, and interpret natural history of Champaign County in East Central Illinois. And we're walking right through the front door now to go inside this museum that's been there since 1968. It originally opened as the Early American Museum, but we are now the Museum of the Grand Prairie. And look at this beautiful place. We have an awesome museum store that we encourage everybody to visit. It's a whole bunch of informational materials about what's happening at our museum and throughout the Forest Preserve District. And look how big this place is. One of the most frequent comments we get from people who are first-time visitors at the museum are, wow, this place is huge. I never knew it was this big until I actually walked in here. What else are we seeing? So we see our brand new special exhibit titled, How Long Must Women Wait? Women's Suffrage and Women's Rights in Champaign County, with these beautiful graphics, especially this awesome, beautiful door that was created by the Sisterhood at Franklin Steam Academy. So stay tuned soon, because our next virtual tour, if all goes well with this one, will be a special virtual tour of that exhibit on women's suffrage and women's rights. Hoping to do that next week. So stay tuned for more information on that one. So we're walking around the main level of the museum here. Here is the exhibit that we will walk into in just a few moments, Grand Prairie Safari, our trademark exhibit. But as we walk around, we have another special case exhibit on D-Day in Champaign County. It is called Call to Serve, Remembering Champaign County and World War II. There's awesome stories associated with World War II in that special exhibit. So look at this place. It's beautiful. It's a great place to work. And we're gonna have so much fun on this virtual tour that we're starting right now. So the Grand Prairie story, I'm gonna pause just for a second. So the Grand Prairie story, in the title of that exhibit is the word story. Inside this exhibit, there are stories of the natural landscape, the natural world, stories of animals, stories of humans, and how all of those have interacted over the course of this area's history, dating back to millions of years ago and getting as close to current times as we possibly can. So we're going to see some awesome stories, and you may be able to recognize some of these stories as we go through this virtual tour. All right, so we're going to start all the way back to millions of years ago when this area looked much, much different. So this first section here, from coal swamps to fossil forests. So millions of years ago, Champaign County was a much different place. It didn't always look like the flat landscape that we're used to seeing today. It was covered in rainforest. It was a swampy land, and even giant insects, some like the dragonfly picture there, could have a wingspan of over 2 feet. Some insects over 6 feet roam in the tropical rainforest in central Illinois. And due to the land moving, where Illinois is located, where we are now, you know, we're in North America, North American continent, way above the equator. We're actually much, much closer to the equator millions of years ago, which caused quite a different scene and environment than what we're used to today. And as we look down into this case, we're gonna see some awesome stuff. And how are we able to tell the stories of Central Illinois and Champaign County from millions of years ago? Well, we look at artifacts, such as these artifacts here. These are fossils and pieces of coal that tell the story of wildlife, you know, different you know, plants or animal species that were present in Central Illinois millions of years ago, including that black piece right there. That's a piece of coal that was taken out of a coal mine near Danville, Illinois. That coal mine provided a lot of awesome material to scientists to understand what wildlife was like, what this place was like millions of years ago. Okay, so we're moving over here. We're gonna do some awesome stuff here. We're gonna pick up this coal miner's helmet to protect ourselves, because we're gonna take on the role of a scientist and check out some of these fossils ourselves to see if we can understand what's going on in these fossils, what wildlife can we see. But looking at this magnifying glass, we see what looks like a small, almost like an insect-like species. Maybe that's what scientists consider to be a trilobite. Maybe there's a leaf in that second one. We have another fossilized specimen right there that's pretty interesting. Looks a lot like insects that we see today. And there even appears to be what looks like a seashell. Maybe that's related to water and aquatic life from millions of years ago. So we're acting like scientists right now, looking at, looking through this magnifying glass, looking at these fossilized specimens, because that's how we're able to tell the story of this area from millions of years ago, is to look at the artifact. Gotta use the evidence. And that's just what a scientist can do in order to tell the story. All right, so moving on, the land before our time. What we have pictured here is this massive, giant, awesome glacier. Although kids would love to, we encourage them not to climb on that, because that glacier took quite a long time to make. And it's pretty awesome because, as it says right there, imagine standing in this spot 15,000 years ago. We would have seen an icy, icy landscape in central Illinois. And this glacier and lots of other glaciers carved out the flat landscape that we're used to here in central Illinois. And sometimes those glaciers would leave large deposits of rock and soil, making these long banded hills. They're also called moraines. So sometimes we see some long hills in central Illinois. Those are called moraines. Another thing that we see here is this cool cutout, you know, the soil deposit, where we can look down deep underground to see what it's like underneath us, because we can tell a lot by the environment that used to be here thousands of years ago by digging into the ground to see how it's changed over the course of natural history. And we're getting all the way deep down into some bedrock all the way there at the bottom. Okay, let's go over here and see if we can press on some of these buttons. We're not gonna be able to get to all this stuff, but we press the red button. We're gonna talk about those glaciers and how after the glaciers melted gave us the Grand Prairie that we're used to seeing today. Why are there no dinosaurs in Illinois? So that's one question, you know, kids ask a lot. I'm gonna pause real quick, is what kind of dinosaurs were ever found in central Illinois, or just in Illinois in general? Scientists have yet to discover dinosaurs, fossilized dinosaurs, dinosaur bones in central Illinois and in the state of Illinois at large. Some scientists believe that it's possible that someday we could discover fossils from dinosaurs in Illinois. They may be out there, but we haven't discovered them just yet. There's some scientists in southern Illinois right now trying to figure out if there's going to be some fossilized dinosaurs down there, but still no discovery quite yet. And part of the reason behind that is that where these fossils would be located in the sediment has been eroded thanks to the ever-changing natural landscape that Illinois has faced over the course of being extremely hot millions of years ago in swampy land located near the equator, and you know, really cold ice age style climate that we experienced, you know, tens of thousands of years ago. So an aquifer, we can learn a little bit about an aquifer by touching the blue button there. Aquifer provides 850,000 people fresh drinking water in central Illinois and beyond. All right, let's look at some of the my more favorite pieces from this exhibit. What looked like some bones down there. So those are actually, one of those is a mammoth tooth, and the other one is a mastodon tooth. And we're going to see if we can try to tell the difference between what a mammoth or mastodon tooth is. So these were, you know, if you've never seen a woolly mammoth before or a mastodon before in pictures or at other museums, it looks like a large hairy elephant, but they are extinct, no longer walking the planet. So these were large woolly creatures, had trunks and tusks, just like elephants do, but mammoths were much more closely related to modern elephants. And mastodons were a little different from the modern elephants that we see today. And one of the big differences between the two, between a mammoth and a mastodon, is in their teeth. Mastodon chews on, you know, tree branches and some tough stuff, and it's going to have some teeth that need to crunch up a whole bunch of tree branches and hard things. So it's going to have, you know, some big chunks on its teeth as well to chomp up that stuff. Mammoth teeth, however, have smooth ridges because mostly what they eat are going to be more green things like grasses and flowers. So it's going to be used, their teeth are going to be used to grind up things. So knowing that, let's see if we can take a look down below and see if we can identify what's a mammoth tooth and what's a mastodon. So this one, it's got, I mean, it kind of looks like a huge human molar. It's got those big protrusions out of it. And this one, it's got some nice smooth ridges, which, you know, may be more suitable for grinding up some leaves and some flowers. So looking at those, we can tell that the top case, after what we just talked about, is a mastodon tooth that was actually found in Gifford, Illinois. Gifford is just outside of Rantoul, right here in Champaign County, where this mastodon tooth was found. And the bottom case, that one with the smooth ridges, holds a mammoth tooth found near Pekin in Tazewell County, right here in Illinois again. So that's pretty cool. Those are some of my favorite pieces from this exhibit, looking at those woolly mammoth and mastodon teeth. Okay, where to next? So let's walk into the exhibit here. We see woolly mammoth there, a life-size woolly mammoth on that awesome cutout that was done by our graphic artist, Jan Adams, when she put this exhibit. So let's take a step back, take in that woolly mammoth. And that quote up there is a quote that I really like. It goes hand in hand with what this exhibit is all about. It says, there have been great societies that did not use the veal, but there have been no societies that did not tell stories. And that was from Ursula K. Le Guin. And that's an awesome quote, you know, because we all have a story. Everything has a story. And we love to tell stories at the Museum of the Grand Prairie. Okay, so what else do we see here? There is what looks like a bison, life-size cutout of a bison too. But let's take a look at this artwork here, because before there was written language, how people communicated and preserved stories was through artwork. So if you look at these cave etchings and these cave paintings, this is what early humans would use in order to communicate, not only to themselves, but, you know, hopefully leave behind some stories for those far into the future. And there have even been some cave paintings and etchings found in Illinois as well too, including the Piassaw bird, which was found in Western Illinois. Piassaw bird, historians believe would look like would be that small white picture there on the far left. And then there's been a later rendition of the Piassaw bird painted on that far right, that more colorful one. Here's another awesome piece from a mammoth. This giant bone is actually part of an upper arm bone, a humerus bone from a woolly mammoth. And look how massive that is. That's probably larger than my legs combined. And that's one leg of a woolly mammoth. Through that life-size cut out of bison. Bison roamed for a long time in central Illinois, and their history had ebbs and flows. We'll talk about that a little bit later. All right, so looking at other parts of this exhibit, so after the Ice Age and ice melted and these glaciers melted, it provided a really rich soil, a really rich environment for the Grand Prairie to take place. And including woolly mammoths and mastodons, some other megafauna that were present included giant sloths, over 6 feet tall, large wolves, saber-toothed cats, and much more. But unfortunately, all of those are now extinct because, you know, our landscape has changed considerably, you know, since those animals roam central Illinois. All right, so looking elsewhere in this exhibit, there's a really cool piece down below here from, that's probably one of the older pieces in the whole museum, 150,000-year-old piece of spruce. Scientists look at trees and, you know, fossilize, sometimes fossilize plants in order to tell what the landscape was like from long ago. And now we're seeing a recreation of the Grand Prairie that used to be present in central Illinois. There is very, very little prairie left, original prairie left. Most of it is restored, like Buffalo Trace Prairie across the way from the museum. You know, we do our best to restore it. And on the ancient prairie, scientists can discover what sort of wildlife and humans would be present. Look at all that evidence that we saw down there that could have been found from Native Americans. So please touch, look at that. That is an atlatl, which was a weapon that was used by early humans, Native Americans. They killed those large animals such as mastodons, woolly mammoths. And let's get our hands on that skull there. That skull was very similar to bison skull as well. All right, so fire, everybody loves fire. The prairie actually grew accustomed to liking fire. So we're gonna press this green button and see what happens when we press this green button. Sounds like we got possibly a storm brewing. Lightning, thunder. Tomorrow we're gonna have some lightning and thunder come to central Illinois. Lightning crash. Poor lightning crash, shook the camera even. Now it's caught on fire, the prairie's caught on fire. The prairie plants actually grew accustomed to catching on fire because as lightning would strike, Grand Prairie would catch on fire naturally and it had to adapt to its surroundings. And since those plants have grew accustomed to catching on fire, Champaign County Forest Preserve District numerous times throughout the year actually does what are called prescribed burns, where they set different areas on fire in order for the prairie plants to become scorched, get rid of, you know, maybe some invasive species. And some of these seeds actually, in order to germinate, they need some fire. And these grasses and forbs, when they catch on fire, open up these seeds for germination so we can continue to have these awesome prairies. So if you're ever on a Forest Preserve District property and you see it on fire, it's possible that it may be a prescribed burn. And those are pretty cool to actually see take place. And our Natural Resources Department does an awesome job having those take place. All right, so let's check out this timeline. This timeline dates all the way back to 12,000 years ago, 10,000 BCE. This timeline here in the exhibit, the Grand Prairie is free. And over the course of this timeline, it's gonna talk a lot about the evolution of technology. You know, because if we look at artifacts, those artifacts, again, are going to help us tell those history. And looking at the evolution of, you know, weapon technology, for example, we can see how this landscape has changed, this area has changed, human history has changed over the course of time. It looks like we got maybe some weapon artifacts in there, maybe some projectile points. And we're looking at, you know, humans, you know, Paleo Indians, you know, 10,000 plus years ago, looking at these weapons. We got some more projectile points. We can see technology improving a little bit as humans go through time, getting up to 8,000 years ago, where we see some groundstone tools start to appear in Illinois. And we've got some more atlatl darts up there as well. Imagine one of these flying through the air, whizzing, and those can actually take down a woolly mammoth or a mastodon or a 6-foot sloth. That would be a sight to see thousands of years ago. 5,000 years ago, we get written language starting, archaic culture of forming. You know, we have what looks like a grinding tool down there and another projectile point, looking at the evolution of human technology and tools that help tell the story of what's going on in human history. So 4,000 years ago, new technology was created, you know, so people could store stuff. Clay pots were being created so people could store stuff. There's a lot of clay pots that have been discovered in Illinois, Midwest, you know, telling the story of humans, what other technologies they developed over the course of their time. We got some projectile points and that larger piece, a pipe, you know, smoking pipe used by early inhabitants. 2,000 years ago, we get to zero BCE, you know, things are going to, you know, begin rapid, change rapidly as we get into the next millennium, into, you know, 1800s, 1900s, all the way up until close to current times. And we see, you know, humans, European settlers come to the Midwest in the 17th century, and we start to see permanent settlements take place in Champaign County in the 1800s and the 19th century. But even though, you know, humans are, human populations are growing, some populations are dying off as things are changing. There used to be porcupines and, you know, more feline animals like that cat that was down there that would roam wild in Illinois. But as things change, as the landscapes change, sometimes these animals will die off, and we, you know, makes the way for, you know, new species to come out as well too. See a picture of a raccoon there, white-tailed deer, the state mammal of Illinois. Let's get a touch on what that deer feels like as well. See quite a few deer at Lake of the Woods Forest Reserve, always hanging out on the golf course too. But you know, the wildlife has adapted over the course of time, and these new species were introduced. Including the white-tailed deer and raccoons over there. So Native Americans, big farmers, grew a lot to help maintain their own population. They grew a lot of corn that they would need to process and grind up. We're pounding a corn pounder right now. You may even use that grinder there to grind up some corn into cornmeal. You know, to turn into, you know, corn flour, you know, maybe bake that up over an open fire as well, Native Americans would use. Native Americans talked about that there was always plenty to eat in this area. And they would grow plants known as the Three Sisters, being corn, beans, and squash, pictured right there, three prominent crops. Most people think that corn is actually native to the Midwest and Illinois, but it was actually brought in from Mexico. Squash isn't native either. Beans aren't native either. Some native plants to Illinois, central Illinois, sunflowers are native. Squash is native. And even goosefoot, which is like modern day quinoa, is native. And this is, you know, some gardening tools the Native Americans may have created out of bone and branches in order to, you know, harvest and farm those Three Sisters, those corns, those beans, and those squash. So Native Americans, you know, there's no permanent settlement of Native Americans in Champaign County, but there's a whole lot of evidence of them passing through. Native Americans such as Potawatomi, Illinois, Native American Nation, Miami, some others as well too. There's evidence of Native Americans in this area. And going back to, let's go back to that sign. It says a friendly welcome. And this is an excerpt from J.O. Cunningham, early settler and historian who had some awesome early histories of central Illinois. And he said, no complaint has come down to the inquirers of later years of any hostile or unfriendly acts from these people, talking about Native Americans. But on the contrary, from all accounts, they avoided doing any harm and were frequently helpful to the newcomers. So in their early interactions with these European settlers, there's numerous stories of it being a friendly welcome, Native Americans being friendly to European settlers. But it wouldn't be until rumors and maybe some unfounded fears that there was going to be an attack during the Black Hawk War in 1832 that made some locals fear that these Native Americans, weren't going to be so friendly to them as they were accustomed to. But, you know, that didn't happen. There was what's known as, forced migration of Native Americans happened across the country, including, Champaign County has a tie to that as well. The Potawatomi Trail of Death started in Indiana and eventually got all the way to Kansas and passed through Illinois and Missouri on the way, including passing through Champaign County sites such as Sidney, Sadorus, and Homer. And that Potawatomi Trail of Death included 800 plus Native Americans being forced at gunpoint to migrate, most of them walking from Indiana all the way to Kansas. Almost 50 of them died during that trail of death. Most of those deaths being children because of, things such as typhoid fever or, just stress from that march. So as European settlers made their way across the United States, across North America, their interactions with Native Americans, weren't the greatest in some cases, that being one. Okay, moving on. So we can see some other things in this piece of the exhibit looking at Native Americans in Central Illinois and Champaign County. One other thing I wanted to read is, maybe we can end on a little bit better note, is this ossuary that's pictured down there on that interpretive panel. So it says, on this panel, it says, one evocative story of early settlement tells of a small group of local Native Americans giving help and comfort to the family of Isham Cook. While bringing his family to Champaign County from their home in Kentucky, Cook suddenly took ill and died. A neighbor brought the family to their cabin, but anxious to return home, the neighbor unceremoniously dumped the body of the deceased and left for home. The grieving family's cries attracted the attention of a group of Native Americans camped nearby who came to investigate. Upon understanding the family's distress, the Native Americans built a fire, provided food, and did all they could to make the family comfortable. The following day, they returned to help the family prepare and bury the mortal remains of Mr. Cook. So at a pretty tough time in this Cook family's history, Native Americans were there to help. They came to help them at this pretty horrible time when one of their family members died. A lot more. I love those friendly stories of Native Americans interacting with Europe. One thing I'm doing here, you'll see that I'm focusing in on these text panels because after this Facebook Live video is done, it'll be stored on our Facebook page, and then I'll also upload it to our YouTube page. And what you can do is if you think we're moving too fast here, you can pause and stop and do some reading if you'd like, because we don't have the time to go through and read all of those right now. But, come back and check that out so you can read some of that information a little bit later on. Okay, so over the river and through the woods, let's take a look at the Sadorus family. We have Sadorus, a town here in Champaign County, and that's because of the Sadorus family coming here in Central Illinois in 1824 by way of flatboat, pictured there. A lot of people, a lot of immigrants came to this area by way of flatboat. And we see Henry Sadorus pictured there, and they would come to this area and built a 16 by 16 foot cabin that would hold all 8 members of their family. Talk about, the quarantine shelter in place now. Imagine being in a 16 by 16 foot cabin with 8 family members all packed in there. That's much, much different than what we're used to today, even in our quarantine right now. Okay, so we're checking out some awesome tools that could be used to build this cabin. Like we see this cabin, this outside of this cabin here. Metal tools, as humans are getting more and more skilled, they're creating some awesome things. People are becoming more and more skilled in professions. One being blacksmiths. Blacksmiths, working metal, including the Cheeseboro Blacksmith Shop and Blacksmithing on the Prairie, one of our exhibits that I'll do a virtual tour of a little later on. but they would use those tools to build, you know, a cabin like the one pictured here. It doesn't look too big, but, you know, cabins weren't that big. You know, think back to what I was just saying about the Sikorsky family. Their whole cabin was 16 feet by 16 feet, and 8 people survived in there. And they would have rope beds, and they would have, you know, furniture, and everybody would have to have a place to sleep, and they would have to, you know, be very, very close, too close for comfort, you know, for some people, you know, here in the 21st century. There's a platform bed down there, not that big, you know, got wood underneath and a small blanket. Imagine trying to sleep on that. Quilts, you know, were sewn, you know, sewing. And seamstresses, you know, out there doing a whole lot of textile work as human technology is improving. And we're going to see some other pieces of technology that had improved over the course of human history, especially as settlers came to Champaign County in the 19th century. So pictured over there on this table is going to be some lead shot and some molds in order to mold, you know, some projectiles, some rounds to put in a gun or something like that. You know, we have some molds over there, look like some scissors. Another thing I see over here, you know, humans want to tell their own stories, especially maybe to friends or family members. And one way has been, you know, a long time, people have written letters once written language took place. Now let's take a look at this letter right here. So it looks really hard to read, because if you look at this letter, if you're able to see that on your screens, you know, paper was scarce. Paper, we didn't have the comfort of, you know, going to Staples or going to, you know, or ordering, you know, a spiral notebook off of Amazon, and it's going to be there the next day and we can write, or we could even type on a computer now. Paper and wasn't as available then as it is now. So what they would do is write, you know, begin writing their letter to whoever, writing it like we normally would, you know, vertically. And then they would continue to write the letter, crossing over the written stories, you know, the paragraphs there, the text there, text that they had already written. So it looks like it's a little difficult to read, but, you know, settlers in the 19th century had to get creative with their writing in order to conserve space as best as they possibly could. Got another cross-written letter there. And that one doesn't have any cross-writing on it, so that one might be a little more easier to read. Maybe you could pause that a little bit later after the live tour. So the museum's original collection from William Redhead, you know, a collection of over 2,500 items, had a whole lot of lamps and lighting equipment. And we see a whole bunch of lamps there on that back shelf, and some of them even hung up, you know, right there as well too. I love the lamps that William Redhead, and those lamps help us tell stories as well too. Historians tell stories. These artifacts in here can tell stories of groups of people whose lives were not often chronicled, you know, including women and children. Like this busk back here, that wooden piece would be used to hold up corsets that women would wear. And there's some etchings on there that sometimes would be used to tell stories even further on the busk of a corset. All right, so walking even further into the exhibit, one of the most influential things in human history to increase population and get people to travel is the revolution of the railroad and the train. And that, when that came to Central Illinois, into Champaign County in the middle of the 19th century, that caused population skyrocket. In 1850, there were only 2,600 residents, but by the next census in 1860, thanks to the railroad, there were over 14,000 people living in Central Illinois that made their way here, mostly by way of the railway. And as people are coming to Champaign County, you know, they have a whole bunch of skills, because as society is becoming, you know, more and more technologically skilled, we're creating these awesome inventions such as sewing machines, making our own china to eat off of that we can order through the mail, since we now have trains that can transport it so quickly. And take a look at these awesome, this awesome tiny tea set as well too. That's really cool. You know, we're starting to see goods being mass produced, and humans are becoming more and more like consumers that we see today, buying and holding in more and more stuff. So I said the railway was one big change in human history. Another huge change in human history is the development of agriculture, and even more specifically, mechanized agriculture. We see the horse here. This horse is helping power mechanized agriculture to harvest some crops. We see that belt moving that's processing this harvested crop here, these belts and these pulleys. But mechanized agriculture would allow humans, you know, even those in central Illinois, to produce lots and lots of crops that they can then sell, you know, make a nice living for themselves, instead of having to grow everything that they would need to eat in their own lives, their own families. They can now grow a lot of one crop in order to sell it a little bit later. So Champaign-Urbana and the Twin Cities, Champaign-Urbana, huge cities, butted up right next to each other here in Champaign County. And, you know, why aren't they just one city? Why can't they just be, you know, together? Why can't they just get along and just be one city? Well, that's mainly because when the railroad was coming to town, Urbana residents didn't want to move up, pick up and move their businesses and their homes to West Urbana, which is now known as Champaign. As new railways and new tracks making their way to town. They both just existed in. So as we start to see those in the 19th century, build up their own livings, you know, making some money. They wouldn't have to make everything themselves. They could actually go buy it at a general store. And here we have this recreation of this awesome general store, what it may have looked like in late 19th century, early 20th century Illinois. And we got some really cool things there. Looks like we got like some hair combs, some combs you can stick in your hair. There's some toys, some smoking pipes there on a shelf. There's a gun down there. Looks like some soaps. Some large crocks, a stove in there, because you got to keep the general store warm. The general stores were great places for people to congregate. You know, people needed to buy these goods in order to survive. They go down to their local general store, meet up with the general store owner. Maybe some other local friends would be there where they could buy the things they would need in order to survive. Food. There's that cool penny farthing bike there with that large front tire. That you could buy if you wanted an easier way to get around. But not only were people trading goods, but as it says up there, they were trading stories. Because as I mentioned, you know, whether it was the Yar store that existed in Mahomet or other stores that existed in Champaign County, places where people could come together as one, share time with each other. Eventually, we'll get back out there and be able to share time with each other once all this stuff is. But let's take a look at this cool catalog here. We got this replica Sears and Roebuck catalog, because now you can order things through the mail, the 1908 Sears and Roebuck catalog. Now, anything you could ever imagine at that time that you would need would be in the Sears and Roebuck catalog, and it could be shipped to your home. You know, it could be a hat, gloves, 49 cents for gloves, even a gun, pay $25 for a gun, 10 bucks for a gun. Anything, you know, there's a stove there to keep your house warm. What else could you get at a general store? It looks like we got some pocket watches there. You could spend your money. There's some more combs there, some hair combs, decorative combs. Got some hair brushes and a mirror back there. All these are artifacts from our museum's collection of over 26,000 catalog records. Lots of objects. Even some eyeglasses there. Look at those old eyeglasses. Those are pretty cool. And then we've even got some vials, and it looks like an old toothbrush and toothpaste back there. My favorite thing, though, in this general store is the ledger. The ledger tells the story of what people would buy and who would actually buy stuff. You know, and you wouldn't use cash or credit or write a check like you would in today's day and age. You may, you know, barter and, you know, trade a dozen eggs for a sack of flour, or, you know, a dozen eggs for a sack of sugar. And I like to look at that ledger, to look at that handwriting and see what people were bartering for. All right, so what else? These goods could be transported on these large wagons coming to town as well, too. We look at this Mitch wagon. It was originally created in Racine, Wisconsin. You know, we can see by looking at this awesome advertisement up there as well. And Christmas wagon. We can look real in depth at some of the parts. When you visit the museum again in the future, you know, you can play with those panels and lift them up to try to find those wagon parts. Here we have a piece of tile, ceramic tile, because the Grand Prairie needed to be plowed and drained and dredged using things like that tile, so we could have more and more folks come in to farm the land here in Champaign County. All right, so looking at the next section of the exhibit, Towns on the Prairie. This is really cool. There's some really cool stories in this subsection of the exhibit. Because as immigrants were making their way by train to central Illinois, you'll have a whole lot of immigrant populations coming to town by way of train. Look at all those people there. We have a Champaign train station pictured there down below. You know, people coming from Germany, from Sweden. You know, after the Civil War, African Americans were migrating north as well. And this is probably one of my more favorite pieces in this exhibit space. It's a glance at the county, and it's color-coded in order to talk about which immigrant populations resided where, and tells a few stories about some of those immigrant populations. So, for example, we can see that in Flatville and Royal, we see that orange color because Flatville and Royal in that area, and in Gifford also, there was a large East Frisian population. East Frisia is a section of Germany, and those East Frisians and Germans would congregate up in the northeastern part of the county. African Americans, like the Smith family that we'll talk about in just a few moments, came to the Sydney, Homer, and Broadlands area. And immigrants, you know, opened up businesses as well too. The Yard Grocery and eventual hardware store, I think, was founded by a German immigrant here in Mahomet, Illinois. And now the J.T. Walker's Brewery in downtown Mahomet is where the Yard Hardware Store originally was. And here we have some pieces from the Yard collection from that time as a grocery store and eventually turning into a hardware store as well. Here we got a video plan of a gentleman from the Smith family. We have a few photos that we'll take a look at as well. I don't know how well you guys can see these on your screens, but we have a picture at St. John's Lutheran Church in Royal, Illinois, with a lot of East Frisians. There's East Frisians dredging and draining the land so they can farm it, you know, getting rid of all that water using that ceramic drain tile. There's an East Frisian broom maker making brooms in Flatville, Illinois. There's a picture of St. Lawrence Catholic Church, that beautiful spire in Penfield, Illinois, that you can see from miles away. There's the exterior of Briner's Confectionery in Champaign, Illinois, downtown Champaign. And here's what it looked like on the inside, you know, a place where the Briners had a whole lot of candy and other sweets. Here's a Knights of Columbus Hall and Ivesdale Inn in Ivesdale, just here in Champaign County. Another beautiful picture of a church, St. Joseph Catholic Church in Ivesdale. Here's a picture of a street in Sydney, Illinois, some early homes that were originally built. And then we have George Smith. George Smith was an escaped slave. He was in the army during the Civil War, and after his service, he bought 80 acres of land outside of Broadlands, Illinois. And eventually he would give that 80 acres 437 acres and become one of the wealthiest men in Illinois when he was living at that time. And the Smith family was a successful family, as I mentioned, in the Broadlands and Homer, a section of the county. And one of George Smith's sons that we're going to see in just a few moments was a big history maker at the University of Illinois as well. So his name was William Smith. He's the son of George and Mary, and he was the first African-American graduate pictured right there from the University of Illinois. He was the first editor of what was known as the Illini, now known as the Daily Illini, the student newspaper. He would go back to school and get a civil engineering degree and would travel the world helping build grain elevators in such places as Argentina. He lived in Buenos Aires for a long time and was a successful individual from the Smith family here in Champaign County. Here we saw the word Sholem. Sholem is, you know, highly recognizable by a lot of people in Champaign County because that's where the pool is in Champaign. But the Sholem family was a successful Jewish family that had a shoe business in Champaign County for a long, long time, 100 plus years. And there we see the inside of the Sholem family shoe business that was in downtown Champaign. It was a celebrated business, 100 years in business, celebrated in 1972. They got, you know, this letter from the governor in 1972 commending their service. And the Sholems were known for their parade float as well, too, looking like a giant shoe that would be in 4th of July parades year after year. And then we see this other advertisement, this newspaper advertisement, looks like it was published in the Courier, you know, describing the shoe business. And some of these shoes that we'll see here, you know, are from the Sholem collection as well, too. There it is, you know, in downtown Champaign, you know, the Sholem family business, big black pair of boots there. Some smaller boots, those are probably some kid shoes, some shoe molds there, in order to help make the shoes. Oh, look at those. There's another picture of the Sholem business front. Look at those little white boots there. Those are pretty cool. Those are probably kids' boots. Got a brown boot there, and looks like a sizer. You know, you can get yourself size. You know what size shoe you wear. And it's interesting to see. These are not as wide as the shoes that we have today. Humans were smaller back then, you know, 100 plus years ago. Their feet aren't as wide as our feet are now because, you know, part of our human story is, you know, we continue to adapt, continue to change. Let's go inside. Let's step inside the cathedrals of the Grand Prairie grain elevators. Central Illinois is super flat. And if you're out in the middle of nowhere, you know, out in the country in central Illinois, one way you can find civilization in a town is to look for the grain elevators. That's why they were called the cathedrals of the prairie, because you can see them for miles and miles. These grain elevators would be a place where farmers could deposit large amounts of grain, you know, things such as flax that we picked up there. You know, other things that farmers could grow. Barley would be another example. But these massive structures, you know, were huge pieces of technology to help the agriculture industry grow and flourish here in central Illinois. Agriculture is big in Illinois. We have some of the best soil on the entire planet here, and these grain elevators help tell the story of civilization, a large civilization. Like, there's the Gifford elevator. In Gifford here in Champaign County, there's an elevator in St. Joseph. There's a co-op, Thomason Cooperative Grain Elevator, just outside of Rantoul. Grain elevator in Mahomet. They're in downtown Mahomet, still there. There's a grain elevator in Homer, Illinois. But, you know, these are these skyscraper-like structures where we can see evidence of, you know, a history of agriculture, a history of farming in central Illinois towns. Looking up top, look how tall that goes up there here in our grain elevator in the museum. Okay, we're getting close to the end of the exhibit here. Here we have Saving Our Stories. You know, this is a recreation of an early living room, what a living room may have looked like. You know, whether it's, you know, in a house pictured, that was pictured up there, like the Burnham Mansion up there to the right. It's a picture of the Burnham family mansion there that is no longer there. But living rooms, family rooms, whatever you want to call it, are often a place where stories get told, whether it's, you know, sharing stories with each other, listening to stories being told on the radio, capturing stories with cameras, or keeping photographs of family members, or listening to music. Living rooms for a long time have been a place where stories have been shared, continue to be shared here in the 21st century. One way we're able to learn about, you know, how we're able to save these stories and continue to tell them is thanks to some awesome record keeping done by some early Champaign County residents, including A.G. Little. This is a transcribed version of A.G. Little's diary, who was a Champaign County resident starting in 1892 and going for 10 plus years, that diary does, and talks about every single day of his life. And we're able to learn about the story of Champaign County at that time. That's one way we're able to learn, is by looking at A.G. Little's diary, for example, and other diaries, these written accounts, these primaries. And we encourage other people to write your own story, to preserve those stories. Let's check out this story that a museum visitor wrote recently in our writing desk. Write your own story here. It says, I was born in the year 1996. That's not too long ago. I've had a few jobs in my life so far. I've been a squirrel mascot for my university. That's interesting. And a potato inspector for the Scottish government. Wow. I'm currently studying at the University of Illinois, and I like it here. Signed, Ewan, age 23. So we all have a story, you know, whether we write it down or not, and we share it at the museum, or, you know, we think about it, we all have our own story. And, you know, it's very, very important to continue to tell those stories, you know, throughout history. That's what we love to do at the Museum of the Grand Prairie. Each artifact has a story. Each photo has a story. We encourage folks to write down your own stories. You know, catalog your lives so your story can be told for generation after generation. And then how do we preserve these stories? We have this rendition, recreation of our collections workroom that's in the back of the museum, far away from this exhibit space. Here we have some volunteers. There's Claudine, a longtime museum volunteer, collections volunteer, longtime volunteer to Madeline Garvey as well. Shout out to them. But, you know, thanks to our volunteers, we're able to preserve our stories. Our volunteers in our collections department work tirelessly on things such as the Doris K. Wiley Hoskins Archive to process this large amount of material documenting African American history in Champaign County. And there you can see like white gloves and computers in these archival boxes where we store these stories and catalog them and track them in order to continue to tell these stories like we have since 1968. 50 plus years we've been telling stories of folks, you know, whether it's James Kinley Stewart and the James Kinley collection. Some of these items may look like ordinary items to some people, but we don't see it that way. All of these items tell a story. They all tell James's story, and it's a story that deserves to be told far into the future, including our own story, you know, stories of the Forest Preserve, Champaign County Forest Preserve District, because we have a long, rich history as well, too. Forest Preserve District starting, you know, after World War II in Champaign County. There's the original director of the Forest Preserve, H.I. Galvin, in that black and white picture there. And Lake of the Woods looked much different. It used to be a swimming beach, a large water slide where people would congregate and go down the water slide and, you know, test their lives and survive going down one of those wooden sleds down the Lake of the Woods water slide into the water. There's no longer a swimming beach or a water slide, but we still have folks come in and tell stories of their time on the water slide. And that's, and you know, that's what's important. You know, it's not just us who is able to tell these stories. It takes many other voices to tell us stories. We, you know, we need your help. You know, we need your support to tell these stories. And it takes 1,000 voices to tell a single story, as it says there. And, you know, that's pretty much it, the Grand Prairie Story Exhibit. You know, thanks for tuning in for this virtual tour. I hope you guys enjoyed it. I hope I didn't talk too much or, you know, bore you to death. But thanks for tuning in. You know, we'd love to have you tune in for future virtual exhibits, you know, as this COVID-19 crisis is continuing to go on. My plan is to do more virtual exhibits. You know, probably the next one will be early next week with the women's suffrage exhibits, our new special exhibit. So that'll be pretty cool. You know, again, thanks for tuning in. If you'd like to leave some comments in the comments section, you know, you think this was the greatest thing you ever saw on your computer or phone screen, you let us know. If you thought that this was crap and you think we should improve, you know, leave your honest opinions, your honest thoughts here, because we want to, you know, turn out the best product for, you know, our museum patrons that we possibly can to continue to tell those awesome stories of Champaign County history. This video will be stored on our Facebook page. Hope to get it up on our YouTube page as well. But again, I thank you for tuning in. My name is Pat Kane. If you have any further questions, again, feel free to leave them on the comments page or send us a message at the Museum of the Grand Prairie Facebook page. All right. Thanks again, everybody. Stay safe. Stay well. Hope to see you on some other virtual exhibit tours.